Good afternoon. I'm Warren Hogue, IPI's Senior Advisor for External Relations, and I'm happy to welcome you to this Global Leader Series event featuring Taavi Rõivas, the Prime Minister of the Republic of Estonia. Mr. Rõivas was 34 when he became Prime Minister of Estonia in 2014. And I have spent the last 10 minutes or so with him trying to get used to addressing as Prime Minister someone who is younger than my children. Starting when he was only 20, Mr. Rõivas has held a number of political advisor and parliamentary posts, and at the age of 33, he became Estonia's Minister of Social Affairs. Just to complete his youthful profile, today marks the first time that IPI has managed to be beaten to a guest by The Daily Show with Trevor Noah. Prime Minister Rõivas appeared on the show when he was in New York in March, and he even managed to get a couple of laughs. The Prime Minister is the leader of a country that has experienced significant economic growth since regaining its independence in 1991 after the fall of the Soviet Union. Estonia is still a nation on the rise and is known as one of the world's most wired countries with a highly tech-savvy population. And I wanted to note at this point that we at IPI were pleased 2.5 years ago to have your president, Tomas Hendrik Ilves, here. And we are now privileged to have here at IPI today this remarkable young man to explain the groundbreaking reforms his country has made in its digital landscape, its e-government programs, which allow citizen interaction with government, and the societal and economic advantages that have flowed to Estonia as a result. Now, we are also very aware of the fact that Estonia faces serious national security concerns given its border with a newly aggressive and expansion-minded Russia. And we have great interest in discussing that too, but the Prime Minister will make some mention of that in his remarks, and then we will get to the subject in the question and answer period right afterwards when I will start to conduct that. The story of Estonia's digital leadership is a fascinating one, and Mr. Rõivas tells it so well that I won't step on any of his lines in advance, other than to repeat one thing he said on The Daily Show. Trevor Noah asked him about a claim by Jeb Bush that thanks to their digital setup, Estonians take only 5 minutes to file their tax returns. That used to be the case, the Prime Minister said. Now it takes only 3. Please welcome Taavi Rõivas.
Well, thank you very much for such a kind introduction. And I will tell you shortly that everything I told Trevor Noah was the truth, and the case about Estonia is that you don't really need to exaggerate. Estonia really does a lot of things quite nicely, but we will get into that in more detail. So, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, thank you all for coming today to hear my take on how to build and sustain a vibrant democracy and how a government should interact with the citizens in the 21st century. Estonia is a very compact North European country. More people live in Manhattan alone, yet we have managed to change the world in some aspects. For example, one of them is creating Skype. We have Europe's biggest number of startups per capita, and according to the World Bank's recent World Development report on digital dividends, we have built up possibly the most advanced digital society. And as we talked previously, preparing for this speech, for the last 25 years, we have enjoyed quite a ride. But today, we are the most integrated North European country. Just 2 days ago, Estonia celebrated its 12th anniversary as a member of EU. We have also been 12 years member of NATO. For 5 years, we have been members of OECD and Eurozone, and our ambitions will not end there. In 2019, we will apply for the non-permanent seat at the United Nations Security Council for 2020 and 2021. And such economic, political, and social progress has been greatly enabled by our digital development. Before I go to the main topic of digital development, as agreed, I will briefly touch on national security, as this might also interest you, and perhaps we have the chance to discuss it in greater detail in Q&A. In my view, national security is fundamental for the existence of any state and nation, as well as economic or digital development. Conflicts in Ukraine and Syria are still ongoing and are strongly amplified by growing threats of migration and terrorism. The events we witnessed in Brussels, they were truly horrifying. At the same time, we should not forget that there is a country in Europe who is changing state borders by military force. And this, let me reiterate, is happening in the 21st century. Challenge for this century right now is that crises don't come and go, they seem to come and stay. As I just came directly from meeting with Ban Ki-moon, I could also draw a parallel in the climate initiatives that UN is having and say that the current change in security environment most probably is not just a period of bad weather. This might be a true climate change. And our need, of course, is to adapt to this reality and keep our focus on security issues to keep ensuring peace. And it is our duty to deliver on the Agenda 2030 in order to ensure peace. If we don't achieve the 2030 targets, the existing conflicts and threats will amplify, be it terrorism or border conflicts, and more will emerge, first and foremost conflicts related to resources. Surely, Agenda 2030 matters for wider development even more. Should we reach those goals and targets, we will leave to our children and the next generation a world that is more sustainable, a world where all the people are better off, our environment is preserved, our economy is growing stronger, and human rights universally protected. Innovation will have to be central part of efforts to realize sustainable development goals. The challenges we face and the objectives we have set ourselves are complex and ambitious. Business as usual will not do to reach them. If business as usual had worked, we would not need the Agenda 2030. We should already have the sustainable prosperity for everyone in the world. Innovation will also allow us to put trends like technological development to good use for benefit of sustainable development. And before I move on to special role of digital technology, allow me to explain the aim of governments in 21st century in my view. The idea of 21st century governments is to provide the citizens the most precious resource, time, to actually live their lives the best they can, rather than spend it on filling governmental forms or waiting in the line for a doctor's office. Governments must perform better and not overburden our lives with regulations. We must find ways to deliver government services in the most efficient ways. And that is precisely why digital solutions matter. Simple, citizen-oriented solutions and technology can help create an effective government. Estonia does not have too many people or too many dollars. Therefore, we have to be smart, we have to be innovative, and we need to find unconventional solutions to be effective as a nation and as a state. We use smartphones to get just about anything done online, from children's grades to health records to internet-based voting to declaring taxes. Basically, the only things you cannot do online in Estonia are the high-risk transactions, such as buying property or getting married. And, you know, we still have to show up for that for now. Let me give you a few examples on how we save time for our people and improve their lives. When you start a company, and this was a point I made at the United Nations ECOSOC meeting yesterday, the first thing you do, you go online. And it usually takes you approximately 20 minutes to have a fully operational company up and running. Everything works legally valid, and you can operate everywhere in EU. All the later reporting, such as tax declarations that you need to file in every month, they are all digital. So you don't need to stop by at any governmental office. You just log into the information system at your office. And of course, less bureaucracy saves a lot of time, and the businessmen or entrepreneurs can concentrate on what they really want to do. And this is, of course, make profit, not communicate with the state offices. Now about those tax declarations. That's true that it takes, on average, 3 minutes. The last time I did my tax declarations, it was in Luxembourg Airport. I used my mobile phone. It really is that easy. 96% of people in Estonia submit their personal tax declarations online. And well, sometimes we have heard complaints that people say, probably I missed something because it was too easy or too quick. But I can assure they didn't. It's just this, that simple. And I will come to greater detail why this is possible just briefly in a few moments. But of course, having this all digitally, it also improves transparency and tax collection. Well, my third point is Estonia was the first and still is the only country where you can vote online. And this means really vote online. You just log in with your computer in general elections. You automatically get the candidates that are in your constituency. You choose the one to support and cast the vote. At the last general elections, previous March 2015, 32% of votes were casted this way. So every third vote was casted electronically. And this used to be for young people who are office workers and who are tech savvy and so on. But now it's the common choice for anyone, especially for those who live in more distant places in the countryside, or especially those Estonians who live in Manhattan. They don't need to go anywhere physically to cast their vote. They can just log in using their computer. And the last time we had this, or we have used that for 10 years, we started in 2005. Last time was the general elections 2015. And we had votes coming by Estonian citizens, obviously, from 116 countries in the world, including, of course, island of Manhattan was among the locations from where people voted. And this gives people who, for example, live abroad better chances to participate, which also, of course, means more democracy. So if I explain some particular examples, this is never just to be tech savvy. This is just not just trying to be cool and using technology. There always is a reason why we use technology, and technology itself has never been a goal or never been a idea as it itself. Now, my fourth point could be a nationwide electronic health record together with digital prescriptions. This means that you can go to any hospital in Estonia, and if you authorize the doctor to look at your medical history, he or she is able to do that. I have visited New York Presbyterian. As you said, I was Minister of Social Affairs, which in Estonia means also Minister of Health. And I visited New York Presbyterian. They have wonderful health record there. The problem is this only works in this hospital. So if you go, I don't know, 40 blocks down or how far is the next hospital, they know nothing about you if you haven't visited that office. And why this matters is, first of all, of course, it's easier to treat you if the doctor knows about your medical history, especially if there is a very acute case. And secondly, you don't need to rerun all the tests. If at one hospital in Estonia you have run all the tests, let's say X-ray or MRI or something like that, which are kind of costly, then you go to the next hospital, which might be higher level hospital, bigger hospital. They don't need to rerun those tests. And you can again see that it's all about saving time and money and being effective. And let me quote President Obama. He said that I should have called Estonians when setting up our healthcare website. He did that in Tallinn when he visited in September 2014. Now, as I said, it's not only about being digitally savvy, but it's about difference it makes. Estonia saves annually at least 2% of GDP by signing things digitally. In the whole economy, the save is 22% of GDP, and the signing digitally works so that we have an ID card for each and every Estonian. Let me see one. We have an Estonian present here. ID card, which is, you know, most countries have that. Just a picture document. On the other side, and this we have had for 16 years, since 2000, on the other side, there's a chip. This chip, plug it into your computer, together with PIN, is your digital identity. You log in, you use that. And with second PIN, which is slightly longer, it is your digital signature. It's not like just drawing something and save it in the format of PDF. This is not safe. You know, I was recently paying with credit card here in US. Instead of using a secure method, they asked me to sign something on the square there in the card terminal. They have no idea what my signature looks like. Who here in the audience knows what my signature looks like? Exactly. Yeah, you do, of course, you're Estonian. Well, I try to remember my signature because 95% of all the signatures I give are electronic. So I carry my pen to sign to guest books, like Ban Ki-moon's guest book just earlier today. But signing things digitally, as I said, is not just writing your handwritten signature to this square or to any PDF, but this is a cryptographic way, chip together with PIN, and this leaves an accurate mark, which also has a timestamp. And you don't need to know what my signature looks like. It is state authorized. It shows Taavi Rõivas, and my personal identity code has signed, and there is also a stamp by the accuracy of 1 second when I signed it. And of course, it might be very, very critical for some agreements to know when this particular document was signed. So it's a million times more difficult to falsify a digital signature than it is with handwritten one. Well, I give you some more examples. Our public sector can be much more efficient whilst we use digital services. It is all about saving time and money. For example, digital decision making in the government, which we have also been using since 2000, allows us to save from preparing the cabinet meetings on average 2 or 3 weeks. So the documents don't need to move physically from one office to another. We simply put them to information system where everyone can access, everyone who has the right can access mark if they have any issues with those particular documents. And of course, as you know, it is not possible to bribe a computer. So using digital technology has moved Estonia to become among the least corrupted countries in the world by the Transparency Index. It is much, much more transparent if you use digital procedures. And of course, it also gives a better view for people to understand how government actually works. Now, I have told that to many people, not only in the United States, in many countries, and other governments often ask us, how do you do it? And let me tell you, it's not only the free internet in Estonia, although guaranteed internet freedoms have played a big part. Otherwise, many of the innovations and much of the usage of digital services would not simply be there if we wouldn't have internet everywhere. But what really are the key components? First, I believe it's not technology, it is political will and leadership. You need leadership to do things differently, and also, let me reiterate, take risk by trying out new and unconventional solutions. So we dare to admit mistakes, and we also learn from them constantly. And technology is, as I said, only an instrument. It's the transformation of government with technology that actually matters. Now, second comes the technology. You need to get the proper technical and legal infrastructure in place early on. As the last World Bank's Global Development Report clearly showed, the difference of digital development gains between countries comes from policies and legal systems that their governments put in place to support digital adoption or not. The digital development does not correlate necessarily to the wealth of the country, nor the size of the country. It correlates with the policies of the governments. Now, I told you about the digital ID that was founded 15 years ago or 16 years ago and has been widely used in Estonia. Well, since then, we have upgraded the technology, and now every Estonian mobile phone has a special SIM card that has this special identity component on it. Otherwise, it's simply same SIM card as you have, but it has some special functionality on it, and the Estonian police, which is also responsible for giving all the documents to people, certifies that you are really you and you might use this digital identity. So basically, now I don't even need to plug the card anywhere, as most people use tablets and tablets don't have any smart card readers. Now I simply can use either tablet or my smartphone with this SIM card, and again, together with my PIN codes, I can use as digital identity. And as we have used this ourselves, we have found that it might be wise to provide those services to others as well. As I said, Estonians, we only have 1.3 million people in Estonia, and we have the dream of making Estonia bigger by providing digital residency, which means that any one of you who are not Estonians can apply electronically, of course, can apply for a similar card. You need to authorize yourself, show your identity once at the Estonian embassy or Estonian consulate right here in Manhattan, two blocks up from here. And you can then, in few weeks, get this document and you can do all the digital transactions which are legally valid in all of European Union. You can start a company in the way I just described. You can start a bank account. You can do all of those things. So if you need to run a company in your EU, let's say you are into, you know, producing mobile apps and you need to bill some of the revenue in the European country, well, that would be a very good solution. And as we are still in a kind of startup phase of this e-residency, as we call it, it means that there are not many services in addition to start a company or start a bank account yet, but we will get there. And there are already more than 10,000 e-residents from 130 countries, so the number keeps growing very, very fast, and lots of Americans among them, of course. And the idea, of course, is to make Estonian economy bigger, so to this digital solution together with a very favorable tax system, very little red tape, gives kind of competitive advantage. Now the third pillar, if I may say, in addition to the digital signature and the decision making is government-wide data exchange. We have developed a data exchange platform that we call X-Road, through which the government institutions and agencies are connected, as well as private sector entities can be connected to that as well. And X-Road allows transmitting and exchanging any data in a highly secure manner between any organization and the information system. Of course, there needs to be very clear legal framework, which institution is entitled to what data, but otherwise, technologically, exchange of data is possible. And that provides the basis for companies and people to get things done in a single encounter with government. We have a rule that is called once only, which means that according to the Estonian law, government agencies should not ask people for data that any other agency already holds. Now, that's one of the reasons why it takes you only 3 minutes to fill the tax declaration. It comes pre-filled and people only review the tax declaration. You know, let me make you an example, my personal one. I work for the government. So should the government ask me how much money do I make? They should know. I work for the government. They pay me. Why do they ask me how much money I made? Okay, let me make another example. A person who works for a private company, should they be asked how much money did they make? Well, every company in Estonia declares the taxes every month, and this is personalized. So the government actually already holds the information. Who has paid how many taxes on what person? So this information is there already. I should be only asked to confirm whether this is right, and I should also be asked to confirm whether I had any income from a foreign country. Sometimes the data from foreign countries come off automatically, but you know, some countries don't exchange data this way. So if I have some additional income from foreign country, I need to file that in. And that's it. Very simple. You actually know this already, so you shouldn't ask. Or another thing, if I register my street address in Tallinn, the street of Vismari, I register it once. Then why should any other government agency ask me where I live? If they have the right for this information, if they have the right to know this information, they should ask the agency that holds the residence data where they live. That's it. So the idea is to free citizens from the duty of mailman, taking papers from one state agency to another. Or let's say social subsidies. If there are some social subsidies that are linked to my income and I need to apply for them, then the typical thing to do in most countries is that I need to go to tax authority and get written data about my income. Is that the case? In most cases, I think it works this way. In Estonia, we simply make the information systems work so that the social security institution or agency can ask the tax agency directly. If they have the right to do so, they can ask how much money did I make, so they can themselves understand whether I'm eligible to this social security sums or not. Easy as that. So it's more like a state of mind than using technology only. It's looking at ways how to save money and time for both government and citizens. And the fourth pillar is, of course, the need to invest time and money into building trust and world-class competence in cyber defense. Because the more digital a country becomes, the more open you become also to cyber threats. Estonia was the very first country in the world in 2007 to be attacked in a full-scale cyber attack as a nation or as a country. And we managed to defend ourselves successfully ever after. We have built this competence. There was, shortly after this attack, was established the NATO Center of Excellence on Cyber in Tallinn, lots of countries participating, not only NATO members. And it's very important that every solution we have for this e-Estonia is very, very secure, and we are able to defend from any attacks, be it hackers, be it violent powers, or so on. All the Estonian digital services are built on trust between citizens and government. There are no back doors. Government just does not have a key to get the data. Sensitive personal information can only be opened by public agency only if the person willfully consents. Citizens own their data and can trace everything, even prohibit agencies to using some of their data. And this protects not only from the Big Brother government, but could potentially be also the solution to control the little sister, which is companies who have your data and are willing to sell it to others. And the citizen, not the government, controls the information. So you can say that in Estonia, citizens are, in terms of digital data, the Big Brothers over the government. I think I stop with that. So we still have some time for Q&A, let me just repeat the main points I wanted to make. Using digital is never a goal as itself. It's about taking things more effective, being more effective as a government, providing the most precious resource for the citizens, which is time to live their lives. And in Estonia, we think that this should be the state of mind of government, and so far we have been quite successful in following that. And of course, this is just a start. With digital identification, we have actually endless opportunities to provide digital services. So we are nowhere near ideal solutions yet. Thank you very much.
Prime Minister, I did not see in your list of past accomplishments the fact that you might have been a teacher, but that was a beautiful exposition of the digital land that you occupy, that you are the Prime Minister of. I want to stick to that subject, except to interrupt for a moment to get to the subject of national security. Mm-hmm. When the president of Estonia was here 2.5 years ago, that was really the whole subject we talked about the new security reality in Europe, and it had very much to do. This was soon after the Russian invasion of Crimea, the Russian invasion of Eastern Ukraine. And from that period, I wanted to ask you about the current policy in the Russian Federation that the Russians themselves call compatriot protection, where they basically target countries where there are formerly Soviet countries, where there are still Russian speakers and ethnic Russians, and they, on the pretense or on the excuse of protecting those people, subject those countries, and Estonia is one of them, to all kinds of things, to wooing, to financing, to a word that I hate as a former editor, passportizing. They basically give Russian passports to Russian speakers in those countries. And in the worst cases, they arm separatist groups, as we've seen in Ukraine. This has been most successfully implemented in Ukraine, in Georgia, and to a little lesser extent in Moldova. But I wanted to ask you, Prime Minister, how many such people are there in Estonia? By that I mean ethnic Russians, Russian speakers, who might be the target of that kind of program. And is Russia having any success with this kind of soft power approach to those people in your country? And then also, what steps are you taking to counteract it?
Well, let me first say that, of course, we have witnessed some attempts to do that, but in Estonia, they have not been successful at all. And there's a reason to that. It's very hard to protect people from much higher living standard than in Russia, or to protect people from human rights that we have in European Union and obviously are not there in Russia, or to protect people from freedom, such as freedom to travel freely, freedom to speak out, what you say, freedom of casting your vote the way you want to do, freedom of you know, political plurality, so that you have a choice, a real choice, not only Kremlin and Muppets. So and then all the opposition is attacked in a way. So it's very hard to protect people from those things. And everyone living in Estonia, no matter what the ethnic origin is, value very highly the fact that Estonia is in many aspects much more successful society than Russia ever has been. That's the sad truth about Russia, unfortunately. Now about Crimea and East Ukraine, let me just make some brief comments. I think it has become a very worrying pattern. We saw that already in 2008 in South Ossetia, in Abkhazia, where Russia clearly violated the sovereignty of independent country, Georgia. That happened again in 2014 in Crimea, which was, you know, they told at first that those are separatists. But when we look more closely, we saw that many of those so-called separatists actually were, you know, officers of the Russian army, or they had the equipment that was produced, you know, less than a year ago for special purposes, and you can't really buy them at local corner shops or something like that. So eventually everybody understood that this is not free will of people living in some region, but that is a clear involvement in other sovereign countries' business. And of course today, for you know more than a year and a half, the masks have fallen, because in East Ukraine we see conventional army activity by Russia. So Russia providing tanks, those kind of tanks have never been in Ukraine before. Ukrainian army have never owned this kind of tanks. Some of the models that are present, some of the other weapon systems, state-of-the-art Russian technology, and so on. So in this respect, I think it has become very clear that Russia has involved the other countries' sovereignty, which is something that we as the Western community should not tolerate. We shouldn't, you know, close our eyes and say maybe it is, you know, business of Ukraine or business of Georgia alone, because then we would tolerate the core essence of changing territory by force and the concept of inflation spheres. In today's Europe, there should not be inflation spheres. Countries who are sovereign, who are independent, should be free to choose what is their destiny. And that very much applies to both Ukraine and Georgia. So that's my main point. Of course, Estonia is also a member or a neighbor of Russia, such as also Finland, such as many other countries, right? Japan. So, you know, that doesn't mean that Russia has the wish or ability to deal with all of its neighbors' business. What is different, of course, in Estonia is that Estonia has been for 12 years member of NATO. And I think even Vladimir Putin is not crazy enough to challenge the unity of NATO, because NATO has been very clear in saying that collective defense is rock solid, and it, there is no point in challenging that.
The other point I want to ask you about that situation is, when the president was here 2.5 years ago, in September of 2014, and he was talking about this emerging threat, he imagined that it might cause some countries, including Estonia, to reassess their spending priorities, allocating more money on security and defense in their own region, but at the expense of other programs, and he specifically mentioned peacekeeping and foreign aid. Mm-hmm. I checked yesterday, actually, the peacekeeping contribution by Estonia is higher now than it was when he was here. Mm-hmm. But I don't mean to challenge what he said, but I just wanted to ask you 2.5 years later, has that happened? Have concerns about border concerns caused you to reallocate money and not spend as much attention on foreign aid and peacekeeping as you would have otherwise?
No, absolutely not. Estonia is not one of the 5 countries in NATO who actually keeps the promise to invest 2% to defense. Among those countries are US, right. UK, Greece, Estonia, and now also recently joined the team also Poland. I know that Latvia and Lithuania have taken the ambition, and this has been confirmed by almost all the parties in both countries, that they will reach 2% in the few upcoming years. I'm certain that they will, and I do hope that other countries who have committed to this goal will follow. Now, Estonia has even increased our defense expenditure in the format of all the host nation support for all the allied troops who are present in Estonia for training missions, for exercises, for rotational presence, so on. All the host nation support, all the investments that are related to that come on top of that 2%. So our actual expenditure has been since 2014, when I became prime minister, ever since every year it has been more than 2%. And before that, it was 2% already for a couple of years. So during the previous prime minister's when he was in office, we reached already the 2%. What comes to aid in terms of humanitarian aid, peacekeeping, everything, we see the need to increase it as there are, as I mentioned already in my speech, that there are conflicts that don't come and go, but they come and stay. And we need to support Ukraine, we need to support Syria, but what we have discussed here in UN in the last 2 days, we also need to support the neighboring countries of Syria, for example, because countries like Lebanon, Jordan, also Turkey, have taken a very, very serious role in helping the refugees. So let's take an example of Lebanon. Lebanon is 4.5 million people. It is 4 times smaller by territory than Denmark or Switzerland or Estonia. 4 times smaller. It's a very tiny country, 10,000 something square kilometers, something like that. And they have 1.5 million refugees. 1.5 million. So it's only fair that we support them both financially but also in other means if it's possible.
Excellent. Excuse me. I'd love to get some questions. If you'd raise your hand, I'll call on you. And I'll take 3 at once, okay? I'll start here, number 1, and number 2, and number 3.
Thank you for this absolutely fascinating talk. And this leads to a question. First of all, how can you and your associates educate other countries, small states, but also the big powers, such as the U.S., to advance their digital techniques and to simplify tax reports and everything else.
Susan, and for the sake of the webcast, would you identify yourself, please?
Susan Gittelson.
Thank you.
A great admirer of IPI and Warren Hoge.
I did not set that up.
Fan club.
But then please extend this to the whole challenge of cybersecurity, which is a major concern for all of us, and it has penetrated in the U.S. banks, major banks, and all kinds of government secrets, so forth. What can you advise other countries to do?
Uh-huh. Excellent. And the second, I think, was this gentleman here.
Good afternoon, Your Excellency. Thank you very much once again for your time to give this wonderful talk. My question was...
Your name, please.
My name is Siddhant Ramakrishna, and I work with the Secretariat.
Thank you.
My question was regarding the flexibility of the Estonian government's IT infrastructure in the future when upgrades are needed for cybersecurity and for the technological infrastructure to make sure that it's faster, make sure that it's more accessible for citizens. What has Estonia done to ensure that such upgrades are easily implemented? Thank you.
Mm-hmm. And right up here in the front.
I'm Roma Stibrovi, president of NGO Sustainability. And you didn't make reference to sustainability in terms of peacekeeping, foreign aid, and what research and how maybe you've used IT to advance any research or implementation you're doing in this area. So it would be interesting to hear. Thank you.
If you could answer those three, Prime Minister, we'll then go get three more.
Yes. Well, first of all, about telling our story to other countries. Estonia, or basically no other country, is in no position to tell others what to do, but what we can do is to share our experience and to tell the story. And we have managed to tell it to not only to governments, but also to lots of people around the world, such as here, but also during the last year, I have been at least to 10 top-level universities. Also in the United States, I was only last month, I was in Harvard, in George Washington, and in Duke, telling more or less similar things about the Estonian experience. It has raised interest, definitely. And it has raised also understanding that technologically, most countries in the world would have the resource to do something similar. But the question is whether there is enough political will. The difficult thing is that in big countries, it is somewhat more difficult. In small countries, it's easier to be very... You know, we are like more than like a speedboat instead of a big tanker, or we can move more quickly, perhaps in some ways. But there are some big countries who have followed our example. Japan has now this ID card that they call My Number, and this has a very similar functionality to the Estonian ID card. So, as I said, our task is to share our experience, and I hope that that others will eventually follow.
I'll ask you something just along the same lines of that question. Is this good business for Estonia? Are these Estonian firms that are making money? Are you making a profit?
Absolutely. Okay. Absolutely. It is... let's put it this way. Sharing the experience is free. We don't have any biased interest in anyone using the same technology, because you could even argue that once we have this competitive advantage, we should stick to it and tell others that you keep your paper piles and we will be more successful. But if we look at the bigger picture, if only we in Estonia save 2% only by signing things digitally, 2% of GDP, which is, as I said, how much we pay for defense. So if only in such a small country, you say, imagine if it could go global, so that you don't need to meet in order to have digital transactions. We actually sometimes we do something that is almost the same. We rely on authorization, which is a lot less secure. Sometimes you log into things using your Facebook account or something like that. This is not secure. This is not at this level of security where you can really use digital services. So if you want to take it to the next level, it is actually technologically possible, but question of will. Now, coming to the... But about these businesses, of course, there is a quite widespread knowledge that Estonia has a lot of digital solutions, and a lot of Estonian companies have the experience of creating those. And as technology is quite universal and easily scalable, information system can be used successfully with 1 million can be used also by 100 million. The difference is not 100 times. You can scale it very easily. And as Estonian companies have the experience, they have very high demand for them globally to introduce this kind of solutions together with the local companies sometimes. Now, coming back to the questions, one was about cyber and how to address those threats? Well, as I said, since the beginning, focusing on making all the systems secure has been core value. This has been a cornerstone. You can't skip it in any way, and you need to constantly upgrade your security in order to be ready not only for today's threats but for tomorrow's. And there is nothing extraordinary in this. You know, I have a designed in US product, iPhone. Every month or so, I get a security update. You notice that as well. New version of software. Yes, sometimes there is, you know, Siri gets some additional knowledge or something, but most of it is security updates. And we consider it normal. So the same should apply to the state services. States should also always be able to upgrade the security of the services. And this answers perhaps a little bit of the flexibility issue as well. We try to do it this way, that in a circle of approximately 7 years, we upgrade the systems, and the official plan is that no system should be older than 14 years. So the upgrading and taking things to next level is continuous. When we spoke about the tax returns, the first original tax electronic system, so you can declare things electronically, was about 15 years ago. Now we have improved it already several times, and it's going to be improved again. So we always look for ways to make it even better. And the last question was use of technology in sustainability and helping in various crises. Well, one of the things we have proposed, just to give an idea, is that this kind of secure digital identity could be easily used also for registering refugees. Sometimes they don't have documents, sometimes it's hard to get their identity. So using the digital ID and make it work all around, let's say at least the European Union, that could be a step forward. But of course, there are a number of other examples that we could make.
Excellent. We'll take three more. This woman here in the front row, and all the way in this gentleman.
Hello, and thank you.
Could I ask you to stand? It'll be easier for us to hear you.
Certainly.
Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Lucinda Longcroft with the World Intellectual Property Organization. I'm an Australian of Estonian heritage, and so I applaud the Estonian government, and I think it's a sterling example in terms of the e-citizenship and pulling in a diaspora of Estonians around the world and their support to a small country. My question comes from the World Intellectual Property Organization, or WIPO's experience. We have 188 member states, including Estonia, and we work with them to develop their national innovation strategies. Mm-hmm. And I think it's certainly an inspiring example that Estonia has set in terms of raising innovation and technology to the very highest levels of government. And I'm interested to know at what source is that innovation policy located in the Estonian government, and how has it therefore been so successful in being rolled out across the country? Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Here in the front row.
Hi, Adam Lupel from IPI. Thank you so much, Mr. Prime Minister. I was really taken with your introduction and the connection that you made between Estonia's political and economic development and digital development, how you see them as interlinked. And so I'm interested in how digital development can improve mechanisms of inclusion, both in political processes and in economic life. And curious if you see lessons in Estonia's experience for developing countries and for countries that are currently in political transitions. And specifically then, if I can just throw in there a topic that everyone in the UN is talking about right now in terms of the lessons for developing countries, are there particular lessons for the implementation of the Sustainable Development Goals?
Uh-huh. Thank you. And the gentleman in the back on the aisle, right?
I'm Atlassi Mohamed from Morocco. I would like, first of all, to thank His Excellency the Prime Minister for a very interesting expose. Indeed, at the UN there was, these negotiations for 2030 agenda, and the main purpose is not to leave anyone behind. Now, when we see, I mean, Estonia, we congratulate you for this very innovative things and this rank that you have in the world. And we see that you are, while you are going in a very speedboat, the others are still using their hands. So there is this digital divide also. So what is there any intention, for instance, to help those countries which are far behind, let's say, in this idea of technology of information? And also, we realize that there is illiteracy in many countries where people do not know even sometimes about how computers, in the way they are now, they don't have the iPhone, they don't have, let's say, cells or whatever. So how it's going to, I mean, to balance this idea? And do you have any view for the future for these countries to help them to catch up with those who are advanced? Thank you.
Okay, I start from the end. Estonian experience was approximately 15 to 20 years ago. I can't remember the date, but was to educate people to use computers. We had this massive project where we invited people for free. We had a foundation that banks supported. There was government support just to educate people to use computers. But that was, you know, still when it was it's kind of not so much Microsoft DOS, but it was Windows 3.1 or something like that, which was still, you know, requiring special knowledge to use computer. Today, I think the best educator has been Steve Jobs. You don't need any special knowledge to use this device. My daughter started using an iPod Touch when she was 1.5 years old. And she was kind of confused why this kind of television doesn't work while swiping. So this is something too old school for her. My grandfather is 80, and he has actually 81. He turned 81 recently. He has used he actually never got used to this kind of Microsoft Windows type of PC. And using PCs or even Apple iOS, but he uses tablets, and tablet is intuitive, much more easy to use. You don't need this kind of special knowledge that you still needed. You know, some of you in the audience must remember MS-DOS. You needed to print in, you know, change directory, and you still didn't get anywhere. You just changed directory. Now you click and everything happens. So we have gone a long way during the last 20 years in order to increase the easiness to start using computers. And of course, providing technology such as internet to locations where it's not available in developing countries, that could help a lot. And I know there are projects financed by big corporations, financed by international institutions, that in addition to, let's say, water, food, education, also provide you internet, which is a big, big thing. Especially if you think about democracy. Getting information is so important. I still remember I was a kid when Estonia was still occupied by Soviet Union. It was so big thing to get the huge antenna on our apartment building's ceiling to see Finnish television, because we got information, you know, how is life in behind the Iron Curtain. The information we got was, you know, not necessarily the scientific one. We watched Bold and Beautiful or this kind of American TV shows or Dallas or Dynasty. But anyhow, it was information, and tell you the story that the life on the other side is much better than while being occupied. And now, once you have internet, there is impossible for any autocratic power to keep information from people. And that is a big power. That's a really, really big power. Now, other questions. Kind of, it was the same direction, the use of technology in developing countries. I think use of technology gives you a couple of important things. Transparency, processes are much more transparent. As I said, you can't bribe a computer. In many developing countries, it's sad to say corruption is a big issue. And the more transparent the system is, the less it is corrupted or potentially less corrupted. And the second thing is effectiveness. You really can improve the effectiveness in any field of operating. And while using technology or starting to use technology, you simply reform also to be kind of eligible to modern world. So this is something Estonia itself has learned. 25 years ago, when we regained our independence, we had to start from a very, very difficult position. And that has actually made our experience very valuable for many developing countries because they know that we have experienced this ourselves, and we have started from being occupied by Soviet Union, and then planned economy and everything you remember, and now we are among the high income countries and donors in UN and so on. And now about innovation. I think there are two approaches. One, which is official government policy. And we have made a year ago, when I was re-elected as prime minister, we started with new coalition, the official priority, which is called state reform in Estonia. But well, that doesn't matter so much. It's the mindset of innovation. And this kind of top-down approach to say what we want to achieve in order to be more effective, more flexible as a government. This is a top-down approach. But the other thing that might be even more effective is if we can manage to get this grassroots level of innovation so that every civil servant, this is the I have a dream part when I sound a little bit naive or idealistic, but this I have a dream part is that every civil servant should not ever answer citizens or any colleagues that this cannot be done, but instead look for ways how it can be done. So this is about the mindset or always look for ways to make things better and to innovate. And if we reach this mindset, we can achieve anything.
We'll take three more questions. I have in the back, right? Number two and number three.
Thank you. My name is Anjali Sharma, originally from India. I'm with Society and Diplomatic Review magazine. Prime Minister, if you could please reflect on the relations between India and Estonia in post-Cold War, that's number one. Mm-hmm. Number two, do you have any plans to take this technology to India and work with the Indian government? As you know, IT is booming in India every other second, I think.
And the second was,
My name is Mark Kostabi, and my question is, you pointed out that Estonia is the first and only country that votes online, and then you alluded to Japan perhaps following suit in some of the technological innovations. Are there any other specific countries that might be following suit, voting online? And follow-up question, could you elaborate on perhaps why Estonia was the innovative country? Why not Latvia, Lithuania, Finland, Sweden? And are those countries that are nearby more likely to follow suit?
Mm-hmm. I don't mean to add complexity, but just to add on to Mark's question, this is a community of groups, and it's not surprising many of these questions are about how do you relate to other countries and other regions of the world. Okay. I thought I knew all the groups, but I discovered another one in this community in doing the research for this afternoon's presentation, and that is a group called the Digital Five. Mm-hmm. And that may be part of the answer to Mark's question. Mm-hmm. The Digital Five, as I've got it, is South Korea, Israel, New Zealand, and the UK. So that will be part of the answer also. And Estonia, of course. Yeah. In the back.
Tong Nguyen, IPI. Thank you so much for your talk. I have a question about public buy-in of these digital services. So the convenience argument of making citizens' lives easier by not filling forms makes a lot of sense. But there are other folks who think that online voting could raise concerns of fraudulent voting. Digital IDs might raise concerns about privacy. So I'm curious what the Estonian example could offer the rest of the world in terms of how were you able to gather that public buy-in? And secondly, on the piggybacking on the notion of innovation, for these particular technologies of digital IDs and online voting, how are those technologies developed? In-house by the public sector, or were you partnering with the private sector? Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, I start in the order that the questions were. Am I heard?
Yeah. Yes. We can hear you. I think so.
No.
Oh, no.
I don't think so. Let's see, technology always works better if it's switched on. Okay, let's change the mic.
Now. About Estonia-India relations, the relations are very good. Could be even closer in a way in terms of activities. India is relatively far geographically, of course, from us, but there is a very strong increase in business interest. We had a very good ambassador in India who raised the business interest of both sides to next level. And I see there is a lot of potential. And also, of course, there is a lot of talent in India, definitely, digital talent included. So India will most probably be among the top global players in digital development in the future as well. Now, Mr. Kostabi's questions about voting online, and what made it possible and why Estonia? I think, I remember firsthand. I was part of the very small team that started with the crazy idea back in 2001. I was 22 back then. I was interviewed by approximately 100 international journalists, and I'm sure nobody of them knew that they were talking to a 22-year-old crazy guy who thinks it's possible. But we were tasked by the Minister of Justice to find ways to use this digital identity. That digital identity was introduced approximately at the year 2000, somewhere there, 99, 2000, something like that. And at first, everybody had it, but nobody used that. We still, by the way, it was first introduced in Finland. In Finland also, a lot of people have that. In many countries, people have that. But in many countries, most people simply don't use that. So we took this technology, first made in Finland, and we started looking for ways how to use it. Now, the second question was also about e-elections and how we make it safe and so on. The point was, since the beginning, to look or think how it could be falsified or what risks there are. The technological risk was relatively easy to cope with. And the more important is, how do you ensure that if you vote, it has to be secretive, for whom you vote, it needs to be a secret. So if you go to the polling booth, you need to go alone, according to Estonian law. The same cannot always happen while you use your computer. We can go there together. He is the politician. He influences me to vote for him. I can show him that, yes, I voted for you. And he can give me, I don't know, $100 and we'll be friends forever. we since the beginning, we thought how to make it impossible to do that. So the trick was, you can repeat your vote until the end of the voting period. So I get your $100, I vote for you. In a few minutes, I vote for the next guy, and only the last vote counts. And If still somebody is influencing me to do that, I can still go to the traditional voting, and this officially cancels my electronic vote.
And you keep my $100.
Yeah, well, definitely. We'll go to have a beer together. So there is no point to bribe anyone to vote for you. I think actually it's much more difficult in the electorate booth because everybody's carrying a camera right here, actually two cameras in my phone. And once you have those cameras with you, thank you very much, you can photograph the paper ballot and show it to, you know, somebody who might, you know, be interested in whom you voted for. So I would argue that technically it's more secure even to do it digitally. At first, of course, there was a lot of questions raised, whether this is trustworthy and how does it work and whether the government looks at who you vote and so on. So we invited a lot of auditors, to international auditors, to look at how it works and made sure that nobody can trace back the vote to you ever again. And these kind of things, you know, the procedures might sound a little bit complicated, but since the very beginning, this has been the core focus to raise trust. And there has been no successful attempt to trick the system in any way. So this is, I think, the best proof we have. But yes, the answering directly the question, why Estonia and why not anyone else, is because we actually started using digital identity in the way it should be used. Now, if neighbors start using same things as well, I think it has a high potential. Finns are very close to use some services because they already have those digital identity cards. And also we work together with Latvians and Lithuanians. As I said, this is a completely unselfish approach from Estonians. We want to make our neighbors successful just like we are. You know, sometimes people say that you should be, you know, jealous at your neighbor or something like that. We work together with our neighbors in this respect. And D5 is also, this is geographically very diverse region, as you said, from New Zealand to UK to South Korea to Israel to Estonia. Those countries came together as digitally advanced countries to share experiences. That was the main idea. You don't always have to innovate or invite, it's just a innovate to, you know, in order to, you know, think of a very, very new thing. Sometimes you just share the best practices and this could be the best innovation.
Excellent. Well, that's almost as much time as we have. It's been a fascinating encounter with you. We have a tradition here, which I would like to keep going, that once every 2 years, we have either the head of state of Estonia or the head of government of Estonia. So 2 years from now, we'd expect either you or whoever the president will be at that point to come back. Thank you very much for coming to see us.
Thank you very much.